Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Good morning. It's a great morning. Great morning. Every morning is a great morning for an apex yogin. I am an apex wow yogin. Wow. Okay, so more clarification on this, which is how we spend our days, is more clarification. Woke up this morning, tremendous amount of clarification. It's a Saturday morning, beautiful, gorgeous day in California. I'm out here in a t-shirt early morning, did some jogging on a trampoline, and trying to get my rehab my knee again. It'll get better. It's on its way, slowly but surely. And so we are here to be incentivized, okay, to be incentivized towards what we really want, which is certainty. We can only be happy with certainty because reality is certainty. And what we've done is we've tried to cast doubt upon certainty and try to automate this doubt. And we're stuck in, we have this huge familiarity stuckness, okay. And this is what everyone struggles with. Most people in the world are not yogins. They say they practice yoga. That's not a yogin. A yogin is an identity. I am an apex wow yogin. Wow, that's my identity. I'm not a male and I'm not a female. I'm an apex wow yogin because I practice the jewel of the wow practice, which is exactly the same as like Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj. I read a quote today with one of my Facebook friends of Maharaj's advice, and it's exactly the wow practice, except he used I am, or just, you know, amness. Just focus on this feeling of I amness. Blocks all other evaluations, okay? And then he says this settles all consciousness down, and then ultimately this quietude comes upon you, and you, all the answers come to you, which is true, and then a quietude comes upon you. We call it, Christian tradition says, the peace of God, or the peace that passeth understanding. You can call it quietude. You can call it, but it doesn't matter what you label it. It comes upon you. So, and it's beyond evaluation because reality has all value is everywhere. So there's nothing to evaluate. Okay, evaluation is doubting reality. And we don't need to kill the mind. People use the term mind as if it's bad. Like we need to kill the mind, the thinking mind or something. It's not, there is no thinking mind. It's one mind evaluating, trying to evaluate itself, which is doubting reality. So all we have to do is lose interest in doubt, that habit of doubt, and gain interest in certainty. We don't have to slay the mind. All these talks about, you must kill the ego, slay the mind. No, that's our own creativity being put in the service of self-evaluation. So what we need to do is get used to not evaluating anymore. Okay? Reality doesn't need to be evaluated because there's all value everywhere. This is the peace of God. Your mind is at peace because you see all value is everywhere. So the evaluating of doubt comes to an end. The doubt, which is really expressed as evaluating, that's what doubt is, that just ceases. And so instead of trying to seek value, you see all value is everywhere, intrinsically so. And so then there's no turmoil of doubt. Hope and fear do not arise anymore. Hope and fear do not arise anymore. So a yogin is one who's actually practicing doing this, okay? The wow practice. That's a yogin. So I am an apex wow yogin. Yoga is just doubt trying to stay limber, okay? It's evaluation trying to have fun and trying to spiritualize itself. Okay, that's got nothing to do with being a yogin. A yogin is an identity. Okay. It's not like I'm going to my yoga class today. All right, that's totally different. Now, in doubt, we're trying to fixate doubt so it's permanent, and then we're trying to get rid of the insecurity of hallucination through fixating doubt, making it automatic. And in order to, since we don't really like this, we get nervous, say, oh my gosh, this is not working. So we try to make doubt fun. We try to make doubt fun. Let's make it fun. Let's have fun. So the what we call the feminine energy is the heart of trying to make doubt fun. Okay, and what we call the masculine energy are the followers of the feminine energy. Because if there weren't followers to inspire the feminine energy to keep trying to make it doubt fun, then the feminine energy would say, "Ah, I got nobody's paying attention to me." Right? So that's why you see women constantly paying attention to how they look, how they're dressed, their appearance, because they want to inspire male energy to follow their lead for having fun. Let's have fun. Let's make this fun. So the feminine energy has gotten into religions and the Dharma and all that in order to try to make more fun. They say, hey, this isn't any fun, you know. So we can make it fun. So it's a subversion of it. It's an actual subversion of it. And then there, all these men are now following this feminine energy into what's called spirituality. They say, yeah, this is fun. This is funner than the other. But to be a yogin, it's beyond fun. It's profound. It's profound. We don't have to come back to this insane asylum again. Okay, that's inspiring. It's not. It's inspired. It's not fun. It's steady determination. It's super profound, super confident, and super inspired. So it's something very different than fun, and it's very obvious to me. This has always been obvious, and the ruination of the Dharma has come in. The baby boomers started, the baby boomers, and then their children, and now their children. They said, hey, the problem is religion isn't fun enough. That's why we're not doing it. So let's make it fun. And so they re-empowered the feminine here, which we now have a matriarchy in the world, which is intent on let's make the world a fun place to be. In other words, let's make doubt a fun place to for our mind to dwell in. So hopefully that will counteract the insecurity of trying to fixate hallucination. Because doubt is just hallucinating the absence of God, meaning all value everywhere, equally everywhere. We're hallucinating the absence of God. God is all value everywhere. And so, but the mind is just choosing to hallucinate its absence. But hallucination, again, is totally unstable. Intrinsically unstable, because the freedom of the mind is always at play, and the mind, freedom of the mind, can just decide in an instant, no more hallucination, and poof, gone. And there's all value everywhere once again. It's the opposite of an abyss. It's a complete plenum, a complete fullness, all value everywhere. We're actually hallucinating an abyss by saying there's an absence of all value everywhere. And then this makes us, you know, causes us to feel, I'm deprived. Where can I need to have fun. I need to have fun. So the feminine energy wants to play with spirituality. Let's make it fun. And so this attitude towards being a yogin in the world is, oh, that's no fun. That's no fun. Let us help you. Let us help you have fun. You're not having enough fun. So that's what I've experienced. Everyone in this world has experienced this. It's just I'm the one who's speaking up about it. It's completely obvious. As I was Mr. Serious, I was Mr. Focused, and the feminine energy said, what's the matter with you? I mean, come on, let's have fun. Let's dance. Let's sing. Let's have party. Let's go to party. I mean, you're not having any fun in your life. Let me help you. Let me help you stop being a yogin. You know, that's what they do. And they say, oh, so, okay, I could have fun with yoginess too. We can have fun with that. Here, let's have fun with that too. So yeah, I'll do my meditation, my asanas, I can do yoga too. But I'm gonna make it fun and beautiful. So you celebrate your life here. Let's celebrate doubt. That's how it is. Everyone in the world experiences this. And then you turn to the guys and say, hey guys, I'm serious. They say, no. That's too serious. I want to go with the feminine energy because there's more fun there. We're having more fun with that. And so they're followers of the fun, followers of the feminine. So the male energy is a following energy. Okay, males follow along. And when they follow the feminine energy, they're followers of fun, which is trying to spiritualize doubt, make it fun. Males are actually not the leaders. What you see as males being leaders are just figureheads for the feminine energy, doing what the feminine energy wants. Says, hey, everybody, You know, I'm a leader here, and I tell you, follow along with the feminine energy, and let's have fun. Let's make doubt fun. And then the feminine energy says, good, good, you're a nice figurehead for us. That's how it is, actually. So, when we drop both the feminine energy and the male energy, masculine energy, only then do we be, or are we a yogin, actually. Only then are we a yogin. It's a different identity. It's neither male energy nor female energy. It's a different identity. And so it's puzzling to the realm of doubt, male and feminine energy. Like are you male energy or female energy? You know, I'm not quite reading you, you know, like that. Because the world has become ignorant now of it. We've swept away this wisdom. So it's the quality of the focus, the purpose, quality of the purpose here is neither to be a leader of fun nor a follower of fun, but an incentivizer towards being an apex wow yogin. And in the Dharma kings have both an institution, they both have institutionalization and personalization, both. They're both. You have to be mature enough to handle that. So when we speak, I'm an apex wow yogin, wow. That's the institutional language. There has to be an institutional language. Okay. But there's the guru. It's like Buddhism. Guru, the three jewels. Guru, Dharma, Sangha. You have the guru who is the incentive. You have the teaching, the Dharma, which is the wow practice teaching. And then you have the Sangha, which is your own personal practice. You are the yogin. So you must have your own personal practice. Okay. And in your personal practice, you can call it mantra yoga. In terms of, you can have your I am an apex yes yogin. Yes. So yes can be one way to flatten all evaluation out. Also, you can use wow. You can use imaho. Or aha. So that's your personal practice. So there's your personal practice, then there's the institutional guru and teaching, which we don't want to confuse you by using different terms. So we say, I'm an apex wow yogin. That's the institutional teaching. But within that, you also have your own personal practice as an apex yogin. So you're an apex wow yogin with your own personal practice, and you have to settle on one term. Do not be ping-ponging all over the place and you're practicing. If you're an apex yes yogin, you say yes, just yes. So all responses, all evaluation is just yes. That's a profound one. That will work for you. So I look at these various ones. Yeah, that's very powerful, just yes. Now the play of doubt doesn't understand this at all, cannot. So it says we're crazy. You know, it looks at it, says, well, you're crazy. Whereas in the past, it would look at us and say, well, you're higher class than we are. You're higher level, which is true. That's more accurate. You're sacred. You're in the sacred area. Whereas what's happened in the world now is to say, no, you're insane. You need to be institutionalized and treated with medications or something, because you can't just say yes to everything. You're supposed to be evaluating. Life is evaluation. No, it's not. That's the attempt to kill life, is evaluation. Life is to see all value everywhere in a seamless, flowing way. That's to see God. That's life. What we're trying to do is to kill life. And so they say, if you're not trying to kill life, you need to be institutionalized. You know, that's absurdity. Okay, it's absurdity. So, part of being an apex yogin and being advanced at it, such as I am, is that you work in a way of being a spokesman, like a Dharma prince. A Dharma prince would be someone who is now working on the long term, getting the big, wide, long term picture. Because what those who are still dancing the play of doubt, evaluation, they need a long-term, big picture help. Long-term, big picture help. They need a lot of therapy, really a lot. Not just this one life. That won't do it at all. Most of them don't even get started at all. I mean, they're just floundering. So it's necessary to see the big picture, long-term big picture, long-term big picture. The incentivization needs to take a long-term big picture approach, because therapy is going to be ongoing for these folks for quite some time still, quite some time. And incentivization needs to be brought back in the picture. We need to recalibrate culture here. And, you know, part of the incentivization is to realize you have multiple realms you can go to and dwell in. And I'm aware of this. It's like in those who are dancing the dance of doubt, they're stuck or floundering in the ocean of hope and fear. For them, incentives for them is like, I have two houses and two cars. You know, like that's what I want to aspire to. I'm going to have two houses and two cars. And they think, well, I've made it. I've got it made. You know, this is fun. I'm happy now. I shouldn't be feeling so insecure, but I do, but I've got medications for that. And I'm going to die soon. That should fix it permanently for me. And so, but for an apex yogin, I don't have multiple houses. I have multiple worlds that I can go to. I don't think in terms of houses and cars. I think in terms of light bodies, multiple light bodies I can have, multiple worlds I can dwell in. Start seeing it in those terms. Okay, I have multiple Dharma kings I can call upon and hang out with. So that's how to incentivize. That's the proper way to incentivize. So we have to get back to this bigger picture of how to incentivize. Without incentive, you just stay floundering in fun. Just flounder in the swamp of fun, in the folly of fun, without genuine incentive. And what is happening in this world is they're trying to destroy incentive. That's their real aim here, what's taking place in this world now. And those who have been incentivizing fun for so long, is they say, we want multiple worlds where there's no incentive. Just fun, no other incentive. And we want to be protected from paradise realms and the death-free realms and the Pure Land realms. You know, that's an abyss, value everywhere, what's that? Oh. And so what they do is they conquer worlds. These are the reptilians. They conquer worlds. So they say, well, you know, if I feel like restless and insecure, I can always go to this other world, which is also a dystopian, fleshpot world, right? A whorish world. I got another whorish world I can go to. Oh, great. So let me do that. Let me, I have options. I have, you know, several realms or worlds where I can go to, and they're all very whorish. You know, that's great. And that's how they think. So that's what they're doing to this world. The reptilian mentality has taken over this world. It's trying to, and has pretty much done so, actually. And they're turning it into this flesh-based, doubt-based, dystopian anti-paradise, actually, to try to defend themselves against real paradise. So they're paradisophobic. Paradisophobic. They're suffering from, you know, severe dread of God. Of course. That's what doubt is. Doubt is terrified of God. Because doubt is the whole purpose, is to doubt that God even exists. There's no God. There's no value, equal value everywhere. No, there's different values everywhere. And some are better and some are worse. We have to go seek and accumulate. And like that. That's attempt to be greater than God. It's attempt to change reality. So the reptilians have moved in on this planet, taking it over, and trying to crush any incentive towards paradise, towards death-free realms, towards the Dharma kings and all that, and just incentivize fun through the whores of Babylon, right? The feminine now has become very whorish on this planet. And they're super aggressive, say, you got to come have fun with me. Basically, it's like a mandate. And they're trying to use the men to enforce this. You know, say, hey, you know, you have to follow me, and in order to follow me properly, you've got to insist that everyone must have fun all the time, you know, right? And No more steady determination. This is what's happened here. Yeah, we have to realize this. This is what's happened. This planet has been sabotaged and taken over. And as prophesied in the Bible, accurately, very accurately. And of course, the reptilians hate the Bible and hate everything that's, you know, prophesied what's going to happen here and outed them, you know. Of course they do. And we have been warned that this is what's going to happen to this planet, and that there are contingency plans, there are plans to help Dharmic culture shift and continue to incentivize. If you cannot incentivize here, we'll shift into a new different angle and approach to incentivization. And we will keep incentivizing ourselves for sure. If that means going to a different realm, we will certainly do so to keep the incentivizing ourselves. We have to. It's essential to keep incentivizing. Even when you go to a paradise or pure land, that's an incentive to go even beyond that. Absolutely it is. And we can actually do that here, like the Sargadatta Maharaj, the Dharma kings, they even went beyond the Pure Lands, and they just, you know, they literally experience. Their experiencing is all value equally everywhere, always. That's literally their experiencing, and we can do that here if we're properly incentivized and have steady enough determination. But the way things are going, it's getting, you know, very, very, very problematical, as I see it, because we think we're progressing. We're not. We're regressing back into fun. And the feminine is trying to make what's called spirituality, you know, froth up the Dharma with fun. The more colors and more fashion and more so they're interjecting all this stuff into Dharmic culture to really termite it. They're really termiting it, which is what the reptilians want them to do. The reptilians came to this planet and said, hey, gals, you know, you're not having enough fun here. Come on, what's look at this drab Dharmic culture, you know. What's the matter? You know, these people are deprived. What, you know, they feel sorry for them. You need to help them out. You need to save them. And the feminine energy said, yeah, I mean, it's just like, we feel like we're slaves here, that nobody values us, how we can bring fun to doubt. And so, yeah, can you help us bring more fun to the world? And the reptilian said, sure, we love fun. We're all about fun. We're fun reptiles. And so the feminine energy here on this planet said, oh my gosh, finally we get some help. Some allies have arrived. And at that point, they plunged into their agenda, modern agenda. And they're more attracted to some things than others. You know, any of the religions have a lot of festivals and food and costuming and colors and song and dance and stuff. They say, oh, we like this. How come we can't be more like this? This religion's a little better religion like this. But the, you know, the drab monastic kind of stuff, they go, ugh, horrible. Oh, God, terrible. That's an anachronism. We need to get rid of that. You know, we got to have more fun, more food, more dancing, more music, more fun. And religion can be fun. Let's make it fun. But real Dharmic culture is never that way. It's never like that. Everything has a purpose to direct you towards skillful practice, to more skillful practice. So whatever colors are there, those are help for your visualization. That's all. So doubt misinterprets Dharmic culture. It misinterprets it, severely misinterprets it. And, you know, they believe in the lie of the reptilians. Like, the reptilians came into this world and said, hey, we're here to liberate this world because you guys are really very backward. You know, you don't know how to have fun. I mean, we'll bring all the gadgets and technology in, and we'll help you have fun. You know, what's wrong with you? That's what they said. And they, you know, the feminine energy believed that lie. That's the Eve, the feminine energy, because it's in the service of making doubt fun. That's the whole purpose. That's the dream. That's the dynamic of the dream. And then the male energy followed right along, like lemmings. Male energy is really like a lemming energy. Okay, because I don't identify as either feminine energy or male energy. Both are ridiculous. You know, both absurd. Both absurd. When I was young, I was super ambidextrous. Right, left hand, I could do everything both ways. I was just, and I'm still that way. If I want to be, it's easy for me. I just eventually just kind of settled on one way or the other pretty much. But I was equally adept both ways. As far as, so my energy was not, didn't go one way or the other so much at all. And so people say, well, yeah, you know, what's wrong? you need to sit, you know. But I'm not a transgender type at all. You know, trying to blend the two energies. No, I was a yogin. So yogin is not a transgender situation at all. Not at all. Transgender says, well, yeah, we can both make doubt fun and follow making doubt fun. You know, we can do both of those. So that's still anti-yogin. Anti-yogin. All of these gender roles are anti-yogin. You know, they're pro-fun, anti-certainty. They're biased against certainty. So this is what you get to hear when you're a pre-yogin, when you're in this preparing to be a yogin, and preparatory, you get to hear this information. How great is this? And you get your whole vistas start opening up more and more and more. You say, oh my God, maybe I'm not trapped in doubt. And I tell you, I keep getting these friends requests. I never know what the next one is. And I do a video, and I go in, and exactly what I was talking about, I get friends requests from those who are, you know, the psychotics who are championing doubt. And so I got to tell them, look, I'm your friend also. I'm a therapist. So I mean, people come to therapists and they're psychotic, and the therapist says, that's okay, I'm your friend. I'm your friend. I'm not rejecting you for that. So I'm very kind and nice to them and say, I'll confirm your friend request. They want to be friends with me, sure. But it's amazing. They want to complicate, you know, my mind. I said, rest on one evaluation. They say, hey, look, we have this vast system of evaluation. Here you go. I've got massive evaluations for you, really intricate measurements and calculation stuff. It's exactly opposite, you know, of what I am, you know, advocate for and incentivizing. So I'm part of this incentive plan. The Dharma plan is an incentive-based plan. You have to be incentivized, not to have fun, but to drop having fun, to get away from that, and to be blessed, to have compassion on yourself. We're here to have compassion on ourselves, not to have fun. And the feminine energy just doesn't get that. So you cannot be a feminine yogin. It's impossible. You cannot be a feminized yogin. It's impossible. You have to be a yogin. You have to drop both the feminine and the masculine energy. You see, and that's difficult for everyone. I mean, it's difficult for the male energy to do that. It's difficult for the female energy to do it. But there's no two ways about it. You cannot be a feminine yogin. It's impossible. That's a complete contradiction in terms. And you can't be some male yogin either. That's also a contradiction in terms. A masculine yogin. A yogin is a yogin. That's a different identity. It's not an energy. It's a certainty. Okay. Energy always, it has to do with evaluation. Reality is not energy. It's essence. It's essence. It's idea and essence. It's not energy. The realm of energy is the realm of doubt. So I did, when I was young, I didn't dance. The girls were always trying to get me to dance. Come on, what's the matter? They'd grab me and pull me, you know, and fight and said, you must. And I said, no. I had dance class. I refused to dance, you know. We had to have to dance class. I said, no. I'm a yogin. I don't dance like with a woman like that. No way. I said, no, come on. You can lead. Don't worry. But what am I doing? I'm following their lead and then giving a role to lead within following their lead. You understand that? That's the trick of it all. So the females are saying, oh no, you're doing the leading. No, I'm following your lead to dance. So I can be given a figurehead position. It's like you get a house, but the bank owns your house. They own the title to your house. They say, well, you got a house. No, the bank has your house. They're allowing you to live in the house. Okay. And ultimately, we can pay it off. But as far as the feminine energy, they're saying, no, you have to dance with me. In other words, you have to dance. You have to have fun because the feminine energy demands this of you. But as we dance, you can lead, but you have to keep dancing, which is following the feminine energy lead, you see? You can't just say, no, I don't want to dance. I say, no, you have to dance. You have to have fun. So feminine energy is the one that does the leading, okay, within doubt. You have to understand that. Doubt is a matriarchy. It always will be. There's no way to change that. And we thought, the male energy thought that it had changed that. No. What a comeuppance we've had, male energy has had, huh, in the last 100 years, where basically the feminine energy say, hey guys, we're still leading, okay, we just gave you figurehead positions to keep you from being too restless, okay, but no, this doubt is a matriarchy, we do the leading, and the guys have now fallen back in line, saying, oh yeah, you're right. And the feminine energy is just shameless about it, you know. It's shameless, completely shameless. They'll go to any yogin and say, oh yeah, I want to be a yogin too. Can I be a yogin too? You know, oh okay, great. That sounds like fun. You know, being a yogin sounds like a lot of fun. Maybe I can raise my kundalini energy and get some bells and whistles going. And that sounds like a lot, sounds like a party, you know. It's great. The guy and the yogin saying, no. First you have to be a pre-yogin and then you have to drop the feminine identity and the masculine identity all together and be on this incentive path where you actually experience the peace of God, which is equal value everywhere. And the world has no value whatsoever except as a mirror reflecting this, the fact that the equal value everywhere. But the idea of a world is that there's different value everywhere. So this worlds don't exist at all. There's no such thing as worlds. There's no such thing as a situation of disproportionate value. It doesn't exist. Nana Maima would say, look, you asked me why I'm such a stickler for hygiene. She says, this body only does that for your sake, because you still believe in disproportionate value. But she says, for me, you see that food there? That's, to me, that's absolutely no different than a lump of clay somewhere. She says, I would get the same value from eating a lump of clay as I would from eating your food, but for your sake, I'm very scrupulous. The body acts in a scrupulous way for cleanliness and hygiene, because you still are believing in disproportionate value. So the dance of doubt and fear gives rise to all these sicknesses and illnesses and threats and all this kind of stuff. But it's just literally, she said, I'd get the same value out of eating a lump of clay. She said, I don't even need to eat it all. I can get nutrition just from the essence, just from the atmosphere, from essence. I can sustain my body perfectly. And I actually don't even need, it's just the mind sustains it, actually, ultimately. It's an appearance, is all it is, of light. That's all it is. It doesn't need any sustenance at all to sustain it. There's always equal value everywhere. Always equal value everywhere. That's reality. And that's all there is. So what we call world is just hallucinating the absence of God, of reality. But the reality is still there. So there isn't any world at all, actually. So we say, well, we got to make the world fun. I mean, what we're saying is, but we've got to stabilize hallucination, which is impossible. And trying to do the impossible isn't fun. Okay. It's not fun. You can make it seem start fun for a little while. You can start dancing. Hey, this seems kind of fun. Like this drug. It seems kind of fun. But later on, it becomes terrifying. And you go into mental states where you feel so trapped and so boxed in that it's hideous. Hideous, 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 hideous. And it ain't so pretty to see feminine energy in a severe psychosis, okay? That ain't so pretty, okay? It's not lovely at all. Terrifying. I saw a female who was so messed up, It was so hideous. It was so hideous. Shocked me through and through. I said, and she thought she was having fun. She said, come on, have fun with me. Yeah, I mean, she was still trying to get me to have fun. And her mental condition was so deplorable that everyone was shocked. The other females around seeing it were shocked. Just said, oh my God, that's horrible. So we're spirit. We're not female, we're not male, we're spirit. And spirit is capable of course, spirit is awareness. Spirit's capable. Those women, the females that were there seeing this, they're saying, oh my God, that isn't good. You know, that isn't fun, is it? And you could tell that their spirits took it to heart and said, whoa. Because your spirit, listening to this, your spirit, you're not female or male at all. That's a dream of doubt. That's a belief in disproportionate value, which is dreaming hallucinating the absence of God and trying to incentivize that. The whole female-male thing is an attempt to incentivize doubt. That's all that it is. And death and decay is just an attempt to fixate hallucination, fixate the mind. But your death is eternal spirit. Every single one of us is. Just that. Just that. I am that. That is another term you can use in apex yoga. I am that. I'm an apex that yogin, or an apex yes yogin. That's your personal practice. Institutionally, we're going to use I am an apex wow yogin. So you have both an institutional identity in this, and then a personal practice identity. Okay. Just so the three jewels, you also have a guru identity, because you're the guru of your own practice. So you have this sort of three identities as a yogin. You have the guru identity, the institutional, which is the teaching identity, and then the personal practice identity, which is the sangha identity. Three jewels. So I'm the guru of my own path, I have this institutionalized teaching, which is incentive for me, and then I have my own personal practice. Okay? You have a threefold identity as an apex yogin. Apex wow yogin, we'll say. That's institutional talk. So I am most certainly the guru of my own path, no doubt about it. In the institutional identity, I'm a Dharma prince. And then in the practice, in the teaching, in the guru aspect, I'm the guru of my own practice. And then I use, my own practice, I use wow as that final one evaluation of the entire dream of disproportionate evaluation. My one evaluation of all of that disproportionateness is simply wow. Now, if you choose something else, that's fine for your own personal practice, but institutionally we'll speak of it for the sake of streamlining it. We'll use wow. The entire dream of doubt is a dream of disproportionate value. Okay, that doesn't exist at all. It's just hallucinating the absence of it. It's all that we're experiencing here. We're hallucinating the absence of equal value everywhere, always. It's still there. It's still there. God is still present everywhere. Equal value is present. God means equal value everywhere, always. Or more than all value everywhere, always. All value everywhere, always. There's no way that it can't be that way. And to believe that there's a real world of disproportionate value, and then adopt socialistic beliefs to say, well, but we can make it fair. We can make this reality of disproportionate value fair. That's extreme delusion, isn't it? That's denying God. That's saying we can stabilize doubt. But keep in mind, this hallucinating disproportionate value is just hallucinating the absence of God. And we can stop this hallucination instantly. We always will have that power. So there's no way to disempower the mind. That's why communism, socialism is such utter junk, as far as teaching. Trying to incentivize that is the wrong path totally. You have to incentivize the realization that I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And I experience all value everywhere, always. In other words, I experience God constantly. I'm in the flow of God. There's only God. It's impossible to disempower the mind. You don't take the world as real. You say it's just a hallucination. It's hallucinating the absence of God. Labeling that as a world is very fanciful, you know. And say, well, there's a world to live in. What? There's a hallucination to live in? How stable can that be? To claim that your home and your identity is living in that home is you're living in hallucination. How stable can that ever be? There's no stability to it. Zero. And so we're so worried. We say, no, we gotta learn to love this. And we can make our home in hallucination more, let's equal distributing everywhere. Yeah, but how do we get people wanting to have more? Because they're insecure, they want more. Well, you use drugs for that, you know. We've got to educate them. But how can you educate away insecurity about hallucination? That's utterly ludicrous, totally absurd. We think education is the answer. We can educate away insecurity. So that what they're saying is we can fixate the mind just by believing it's fixated and just saying, or say, we can be happy with total insecurity. We can be happy with fear. No, you can't, because God did not create you to be happy with fear. Okay? Because God is still present as all value everywhere. And that's our natural condition. And we can never be happy denying what we are. That denial is always insecure. So the whole doubt-based agenda is utterly absurd. You have to understand, recognize it is totally absurd. It's the attempt to do the impossible, and that's all that it is. So to evaluate absurdity, you only need one evaluation. A final evaluation, absurdity is what? It's absurd. But we just use one evaluation, and just that's all that's needed with absurdity. Just yes, I see this. Yes. Yes, 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 yes. All evaluation. Don't get caught up in the play of evaluation. Hope and fear. It's evaluation, actually. Evaluate. The act of trying to evaluate. Where is my value? You know, where can I find my value? The mind doesn't naturally do that at all. Because the mind is presently aware, always aware, of all value everywhere. So how can the mind evaluate and accept in an attempt to change reality? It's the only way that mind can evaluate at all. It's a dream of evaluation. It's a hallucination of evaluation. Is to try and change reality. It's the only way this could ever possibly arise. This dream of doubt, dream of evaluation. It's the only way. So the fact is we are trying to change reality so we can be greater than God. Very simple to see this. And that goes nowhere. It goes absolutely nowhere. So the path of a yogin is more than fun. My life has been super intense, super profound. That's way better than fun. Way better than fun. And the feminine energy will say, well, if you ever want to have fun, we're here, you know. The feminine energy is really whorish energy, actually. It really is. No doubt about it. Because when we drop Dharma culture, what happens? Women become whores again. No, that's exactly what has happened. The attitude of women right now is extremely whorish. There's no question about it. Whereas before, it wasn't so much that way. They kind of said, huh, they're more serious. And like, no, that's not it. You know, they say, nah, I don't want to go back into that feminine energy like that. That's not it. And say, guys, follow along what I'm doing, which is not so much fun. And the guys would follow, you see. That's how it used to be. And they say, you know, I think dharmic culture is probably the way to go. So guys, I want you to follow along with that. And the guy said, okay, we'll follow along with that. But still, that wasn't good enough, because you have to commit to being a yogin. So you're not following feminine energy. As a guy, you're not following feminine energy at all. And as a female, you're not leading from feminine energy at all. That's to choose to be a yogin. But it was trending in the right direction. But trending isn't good enough. You still have to make the commitment. So what happened was we trended, but we didn't commit. Okay, that's the problem. We trended, but didn't commit because we said, well, let's just have one more drink of fun. You know, last call, the reptilians came and said, hey, this last call, you guys are, if you keep going this way, you're going to be totally dharmic, and you're not going to have any more fun at all chasing after disproportionate value. So last call, you know, that's what the reptilians do. That's their trick. They said, hey, world, last call. You're almost a goners here. And then what happened was the feminine energy panicked and said, oh, my God, let me have one more drink of fun. And then the guys had no choice. They could either choose to be a yogin or follow along with the horrors of Babylon, which is what has happened. I mean, the feminine energy now, the females here are just whores of Babylon now. That's all. That's all that's happening here. There's a, you know, what's that? And the guys are just whoremongers, plain and simple. The masculine energy now on this planet is that of being a whoremonger. And this is true, isn't it? I mean, this is just honest truth. You know this is true. And you say, yeah. What? But they say, yeah, but what do we do about it? Well, you got to start trending. You have to accept incentivization. And by watching this video, you are being incentivized. So you're doing it. And you have to just be steady in your incentivizing. And keep hearing the truth and say, yeah, I'm in the pre-yogin stage. I'm preparing to be a yogin. And you have to take that very seriously. I'm preparing to be a yogin. You know who incentivized me? Yogananda, when I was young. I came in incentivized, but he really poured gas on that fire, like, wow. Because autobiography of a yogi, he talks about all his incentivization that he's experienced in his life. And I said, well, that's what I want. I want to have these masters appear, you know, to me. Just appear. Yeah. So my whole life, that's been my goal, you know, to let me experience that. So I was super incentivized by Yogananda. I was at Forest Lawn Cemetery in Glendale area of California, and of a service there, and I just found out that Yogananda's interred there, or at least there's a plaque, you know, plaque there. I don't know if he was cremated, or his body is in a crypt there or something. I didn't know that. If I'd have known that, I would have visited it for sure, because he was definitely a very, very advanced yogin who helped. He was a genuine Dharma prince for sure, for sure, and he helped incentivize us. He really played a big role in that. So I've never met him in spirit that I know of, because I'm not a Kriya yogin. I mean, that's different practice than what we do. We do apex yoga here. But still, you know, he played a massive role in helping out that book. Introduce Ananda Maima in the whole chapter on her in the book. I didn't know who she was. I remember reading the book. I read the whole book quite a few times when I was quite young. And I said right away, I said, that's my life. That's the life I want to live. But I didn't quite register, you know, they called her the Divine Mother, the joy permeated Bengali saint, you know, and I'm like, huh? What's this? You know, it didn't quite register until later when I actually met her. And I didn't realize this is the same one as in his book. I didn't know that. That only came to me later. And then I found, oh my God, this is the one he was talking about in his book. And he just said, my God, I've never met anyone like her. He says, I've met many masters and yogins advanced, but this one is in an effortless, highest state, seeing equal value everywhere. And she's effortlessly in this way all the time. And it just blew his mind. She really blew Yogananda's mind and incentivized him to a tremendous extent. When we say that, it's better to say she incentivized him to a tremendous extent. He was just like, oh my God, you know, this is amazing. Thank you, God. I mean, how fortunate was Yogananda to meet her and spend time with her on several occasions? I mean, and he knew it, you see. I mean, there are plenty of family members of devotees who spent so much time with her, and they didn't even know. They just said she's a nice lady. But Yogananda, he realized what he was getting. And he just said, God, this is such a blessing for me. Wow. Wow. I mean, that, you know. So he's a great brother in this incentivization program, Yogananda. He helped out. California helped me out tremendously. Came out to California, as did Krishnamurti, another incentivizer. Spent both of those are the two, you know, patron saints in California. Two of them, Marie Watts, Frank Romero Wolfer, a couple of others, that lived here. Krishnamurti lived here for a long time, as did Yogananda. He set up the Pacific Palisades, the center, I don't know what he called it, but it's changed names, Self-Realization Fellowship, is some sort of institution that came out. So he spent a lot of time here. Keep that in mind. So we claim him as our own. I mean, as Californians, we take pride in Yogananda, we take pride in Krishnamurti, we take pride in Marie Watts, we take pride in Franklin Merrill Wolf, and, you know, there are probably some others here and there. Because these are our incentivizers, and this is our lifeblood, you know. To be a yogin, you need these incentivizers to come visit your place and stay for a while. It's super important. So I keep inviting all the Dharma kings to come here and appear here, and so far they haven't appeared here. Which is a, you know, real disappointment for me. Big disappointment. Yeah, but they may be incentivizing some other place, or they may show up. They may show up here at some point. I'm done everything I can to get them to actually literally manifest here. I mean, Yogananda had so many masters just manifest. They just appear. They just walk in the door. They say, I'm using a light body to manifest now. Yeah, I understand that. I mean, what a great culture that was, Yogananda's culture that he lived in. Sri Yukteswar and Lahiri Masaya and Babaji and all that. They were incentivizing one another. And there are many traditions of incentivization, but the overall umbrella is the plan of incentivizing us to be yogins. That's the whole point of it. Yogananda was not a man, he was not a woman, he was a yoga. A very advanced yoga. Dharma Prince Yoga, actually. An advanced Dharma Prince Yoga, actually. So much so that his body didn't decay. And like Tibetan Buddhists, they turn their body into a rainbow body, and it shrinks and disappears, or, you know, those are very advanced yogins. Tibetan Buddhism has had many, many very advanced yogis, many very advanced Dharma princes. And when the body dies, it turns into light, it turns into rainbow light. Rainbow body, it's called. Not to be confused with the rainbow flag of the gay movement, which is an attempt to incentivize fun. Okay? That's what happened. That's what's happened. Gays are experts at incentivizing fun. They're experts at it. And that's why the females lionize them so much. Oh, those are great. You're helping us so much. Incentivize fun. And that's why all the marches and stuff is, look at our costumes. Look how much, look at our decadence. Look at our whoremongering. You know, look how much fun we can have. Okay? That's what's really happening. And the feminine energy loves that. So yeah, come on guys, be more like that. Everyone needs to be more like the gays and you know, make a life of fun until you die of AIDS or die of, you know, drug abuse or something like that. It's not so much fun, is it? You see older gays, they're not having so much fun, generally speaking. There are a few that hang in there, but mostly they're like, God, that wasn't as much fun as I thought it would be. Right? So that's just a play of a trying to incentivize doubt. That's all it is. You don't have to do that play. You don't have to incentivize doubt. You don't have to be feminine energy. You don't need to be gay energy. You don't need to be masculine energy. You don't need to be lesbian energy. You don't need to be transgender energy. You can be yogin, which is not an energy. It's an essence. It's the essence of certainty. Okay, you can commit to certainty. You can commit to certainty. Commit to certainty. Commit to say, I am an apex. Wow, yogin. Wow. Meaning, by committing to certainty, I'm agree. Now I'm going to practice setting all evaluation down by just having one final evaluation for the whole attempt to evaluate, you know, disproportionate value. It's just one final evaluation, which is just wow. That's it. And when you use just one one term, it flattens it all out, right? Because there's no contrast. There's no play of value, disproportionate value. It's just one word. But you're using it in the context of evaluation. I'm evaluating disproportionate value. Final evaluation, that is just, wow. Okay. Very creative. Basically saying, I was very creative in that. Just wow. You're wowing your own creativity. But by using one term, there's no evaluation of that term. It's the end of evaluation. One concept. One insight settles it all. Padmasambhava. One insight settles it all. Right? Be an apex yogin. Be incentivized by Padmasambhava. So I've been super blessed because I committed to the path of being incentivized to practice dropping, flattening evaluation, that I've been super incentivized. But I had to do it under the radar in this culture, this fun-based culture. I mean, they'll demonize you if you do this. They'll really demonize you. Father, you're anti-women, you're anti-gay, you're anti-fun, you're anti-drugs, you're anti-this. You know, oh, you're terrible. You know, that's what we're trying to get rid of it. You know, what? You're archaic. You know, you're mentally ill. That's what the reptilians told them. Says anyone who is dharmic is mentally ill. They say that they don't know how to have fun. What's the matter with them? So you have to fly under the radar. But doubt, again, isn't fun. It's terrifying. And I can tell you, although being completely terrified is still somewhat interesting, like I said, that's very creative. Like, how in the world? It's not fun. It's being terrified is not fun. Having hideous dread constantly isn't fun. You look at it and say, what in the world is this? That's interesting. Well, how did I get into this hideous condition, you know, like that? Mental chaos, it's horrible, but you still have some poise, mental poise. Certainty says, well, I'm certain that this isn't going to last. I'm certain that this isn't it. So constant searching in the hallucination of disproportionate value is hell. So hell isn't much fun. So the way that doubt is incentivized, if you have like feminine energy and you're trying to be a yogin, what doubt does is tries to tell you, no, you're a lesbian, okay? Because you're kind of serious, you're not so much into fun. So you need to be a lesbian and have more fun, you know? Or if you're a male energy and you're trending towards being a yogin, they'll say, you look like you're gay, so you should be gay and you should learn how to have more fun, okay? But that's still the play of energy and the trying to incentivize fun. What you're really trending towards is spiritual trend to being a yogin, which is beyond energy, which is essence and idea and certainty. So you're neither a male nor a female energy. You're not either one of that. You're not in that realm at all. So if you can realize that, you'll be way better off. You see, and they're trying to reconstruct history and say, well, the women who are like very serious nuns and everything say, oh, they're all lesbians, that's why. No, they weren't. No, they weren't. They were trending to being yogins. But and the guys that were not into women in the past, they said, well, they were all gays. You know, that's what they were in the closet. And that's a total lie. I mean, this whole the trying to incentivize doubt has lied about history, totally lied about it. Said every guy that was, you know, there was a renunciate, celibate priest, oh, that's only because homosexuality was a sin back then. Otherwise, they would have come out of the closet and had fun. You know, unlimited gay sex, all fun. Yeah, that's what they would have done. Total lie. Total lie. They were in the pre-yogin stage. They were preparing to be yogins is what we were doing. Same with the females. They were not trying to be lesbians. They were trying to get away from fun. They were very honest. So there's a mass that reptilians have told, just a massive, you know, subversive lie about the history of this planet. And that's taken for gospel now in the world by the techies and these third generation of the boomers, you know, these spawn, these whores and whoremongers have misinterpreted history totally. And so they're doomed to go through a cycle of hell. Another cycle of hell is what they're dooming themselves to. So we have to take the bigger picture of this and how to help them out of that. But don't any of you fall for this, you know, these lies, vicious lies they are. Vicious lies. And they're still trying to do that to me. Say, okay, you're not interested in women? Oh, you must be gay, you know, like that. That's what they try to think. It's ridiculous, you know, because they can't think otherwise. They're trying to incentivize doubt. So in their mind, a yogin is like the worst thing you could possibly be. And so they're trying to help you avoid being a yogin. So let me help you avoid being a yogin. And they're just shameless about it. So we live in Sodom and Gomorrah, which is the realm now of whores and whoremongers. That's it. That's it. And we know how that ended, don't we? Destruction by fire. As a sign to future generations to be aware of this. But of course, that's the we all fall down game of let's just all die together as a group. Group death. This whole thing about groups is really group death. Okay, let's all die together. So, meaning, if we all die together, we can fixate. That'll be more powerful in fixating the mind, and then we won't have this horrible insecurity that's causing us so much trouble, you know. And then we can enjoy disproportionate value in the future. But first, we have to have this collective sacrifice. So collective sacrifice has been used throughout history. So let's all die together. That should do it. The Holocaust was collective sacrifice, okay? What's coming in the future here is collective sacrifice. It's thinking that that will enable us to fixate the mind in doubt, and we won't have this insecurity of hallucination anymore. And then we'll have the golden age. But first, we must have collective death. We must have collective death. And so, you know, it takes... The mind dreams this collective death. You need the Jews and the Nazis, for instance, in order to produce this collective death. And in this case, now we need asteroids hitting the world and 7 billion people on the planet for a collective death. This is what the mind is up to. The dance of doubt is up to. That's what it's up to. And diverting us from being yogins and avoiding this by fun. Let's have fun. Let's forget the fact we can shift to another realm, right? Let's forget about that. Let's have fun. Let's be whoremongers and whores. And this world is absolutely hell-bent on collective suicide is what they're really after. Thinking that will finally fixate the mind, and hallucination will now be stable, and then we can continue on, make a utopia out of disproportionate value. Yeah. Zero chance. It's totally absurd, totally impossible. The mind is inherently and always completely free in every instant, completely free. We'll always be able to drop hallucination in an instant, totally drop all hallucination in an instant, and experience all value everywhere, always, which is God. Will always be that way. There's nothing we can do to change that. So a massive collective suicide does nothing at all. Just a total waste of time. Just aimlessness. Meaningless, aimless nothingness. You know, that's all it is. Just an abyss of aimlessness. A futility. An abyss of futility is all it is. So this is Dharma Prince talk. I'm an apex wild yoga and a Dharma Prince of apex wild yogin. So this is how we talk. We're able to talk like this. We're able to share like this. There's nobody else. You're not going to hear anybody else speak like this, are you? There's no way. They're too afraid they might get cut out of the fun. Right? And now, we're so addicted to fun. It's not like we have to drop all fun completely. So I still sing. I still have fun. I might want to play golf a little bit again. And I enjoy singing, but that's about it. I don't really enjoy food or anything else. I just allow myself like one enjoyment. I allow myself one enjoyment, which is singing. I do that occasionally. And it's fun. It's creative. I'm very creative with it. So I don't just sing to have fun. To me, I'm able to be very creative with it. And I can step out of it. I can step out of I have fun stepping out of structure in this way. But it's just that. I don't make it part of a fun culture. Okay. Just like I use wow, that's just a word. So I still use a word. It's a definition. It's a concept. Wow. But I use just a one word to flatten all other evaluations. And I use singing as just one fun to flatten all other fun. And ultimately, Tantra is that practice, the Tantra of Padmasambhava and Tibetan Buddhism, all that, Vajrayana Buddhism, it is just use one fun to flatten all their fun, one concept to flatten all theirs. So that's where the confusion arises in people's minds about that. Because a few, not a lot, use sexual Tantra as a way to that. It's one having fun, but no other fun. But in a whoremongering world, that's not the right way to go at all. Not the right way to go. That'll pull you right back into the whole fun thing. That has to be done by very advanced ones are very advanced, deciding that's the only fun they're going to have, and they're going to use it to go beyond fun completely. So that's but the whoremongering incentivizers of doubt has seized upon that very small subset of Tantra and tried to claim that's all that Tantra is. That's it. It's sexual Tantra. That's it. Super big lie. Vicious lie. Vicious lie. You have to understand it's all about allowing yourself just one fun and no others, really, to go beyond fun entirely, to drop it all. Really, okay. So for me, it's just singing. That's what I do. I'm not interested in any other fun. But I absolutely advise staying away from sexual Tantra in these times. That's very much the wrong approach now. Very much the wrong approach. Because that will easily sweep you away. Easily sweep you away. It's very rare that there are those who can do it that way. It's possible, yes. We're not going to say it's impossible. It's ill-advised and very rare, let's put it that way. But if you're an anomaly and it works for you, then it works for you. That's fine. But certainly from an institutional standpoint, we cannot advise that. That's ill-advised at this time, juncture in the world. Very ill-advised. But again, we are not precluding, saying it's impossible. It's impossible. I mean, literally anything's possible. I mean, you can have fun, you know, hitting your head against the wall. That's fun for you. and that's all, that's your only fun. There's that too will work. So we don't call you insane. If you're a yogin and that's your own unusual practice, that is possible. It's rare, you know, but anomalies are part of the whole thing. I mean, even crazy wisdom is part of the whole thing, you know, but it's very rare, it's ill-advised, and it's anomaly. It's an anomaly. But because you're supposed to just do one and forget about all the others. So crazy wisdom is not going about having fun with everything. That is not it at all. That's trying to incentivize doubt. But you see these eccentrics and they just keep doing one thing. That's actually a yoga practice, a tantric practice. They're just doing one, they're choosing just one thing to do. Or you can do it with action too, just one action to flatten all their action. One fun activity to flatten all fun. One concept to flatten all concepts. One definition to flatten all definitions. But the more abstract your practice is, the more successful it will be. So wow is super, super, super abstract. That's why we use it as the institutional term. We want to trend towards super abstraction. So that should be our root practice. And like for me, I sing a little bit to have fun. And so that's my kind of action, fun action practice. Just one, to flatten all other practices. And it doesn't involve any special relationship, which is very important. It's much safer to not involve any special relationship in your practicing. You're the guru of your own practice. When you try to do a practice with someone else, who's the guru of the practice, you know? Then you're back in the male-female thing. I mean, and you're back in all sorts of very slippery slope. Okay, you're back in energy. You don't want to be involved in the dance of energy at all. You're the guru of your own practice. I don't relate to energy at all. I never have. I don't even understand electricity. I don't relate to energy. I don't understand electromagnetism, electricity, to all these energetic dynamics. I don't have any understanding of them at all. To me, it's just magic. You know, it's just wishful thinking is all it is. And they would say I'm a primitive, but no, I understand certainty and essence and idea. That's reality. How can you say reality is primitive? That's arrogance. It's trying to change reality. It's electromagnetism that's arrogance. And technology is just arrogance. Electricity is arrogance, actually. God is not electrical. No. That's an attempt to change God. God is still present as equal value everywhere. Whether there's electricity or not makes no difference. Electricity is an attempt to change God, actually. And yet, electricity still takes place within God. So they can say, well, there's still electricity is equal value. Everything is equal value. There's no way to define equal value everywhere. Always, is there? You can't define it as electricity. You can't say anything about it at all. Whatever you say is completely redundant from the very beginning. So you're not really saying anything. Now, you can have a spouse, and they can be preparing to be a yogin, and you're preparing to be a yogin, and that's a good situation. That's a good situation, actually. And so the feminine will say, hey, I'm not really trying to generate fun. And the male can say, well, I'm not really trying to follow fun either. And you both say, well, we're both okay with that. We're okay with that. And so that's a great situation. And generally, most people do it that way because most people are not able to step out of that so decisively and commit so decisively where you step out of the whole energy dynamic entirely. There's a tendency to do it in relationship, to de-emphasize the relationship is what you do. You have a relationship that's based on de-emphasizing relationship. and each one of you being the guru of your own practice and transcending male-femaleness, transcending energy, and not transcending it, but so much, but losing interest in it and committing to being a yogin, which is neither male nor female, nor a combination thereof. It's threefold, right? It's the institution, the guru, the institution, the practice. The guru, the teaching, the practice. The guru, the teaching, the practice. Threefold identity, which is identity based on certainty, equal value, all value equally everywhere, always. All value equally everywhere, always. So it's transferring out of doubt and committing to certainty. You're committing to certainty rather than doubt. That's what a yogin does. Yogin's committed to certainty, experiencing certainty. Male, female is committed to incentivizing doubt. Incentivizing doubt. Yogin is committed to incentivizing certainty. Okay, so totally different. Totally different. It's not a matter of working on one and evolving and transcending it. No. It's either doubt or certainty. That's the choice option we have. You're either committed to incentivizing doubt or you're committed to incentivizing certainty. One or the other. They're mutually exclusive. You cannot have disproportionate doubt and at the same time cannot be committed to searching within disproportionate doubt and being committed to accepting that there's all value everywhere, always. Those two positions are mutually exclusive. Mutually exclusive. You can have both the manifest and unmanifest, but there's still equal value everywhere. Okay? Always. Makes no difference whether anything's manifest or unmanifest. There's still all equal value, all value equally everywhere, always. That's God. God is omnipresent as that. There's no way around that. Whether you're manifest, it's true, and whether you're unmanifest, it's true. Whether you play with as unmanifest or whether your play is manifest, makes no difference. God is still, omnipresent. Always omnipresent. And we say, well, that's no fun. Well, fun is no fun, actually. Doubt is no fun. Fun is the way we try to incentivize doubt, to try and conquer God, really. Conquer our insecurities. The insecurity of hallucination, the only way to do that would be to fixate the mind. It's the only way. And we can't fixate the mind because we'd be changing freedom, changing what God created. So it's impossible. So incentivizing doubt, it's not fun. It's hell. And you keep experiencing that lifetime after lifetime. Eventually you'll start paying attention to this sharing here that we have. This incentivizing of certainty is what it is. It's a better way than saying, I don't like the term teaching. That's wrong. Because then you think there's something to learn. No, we're incentivizing certainty here. That's what I'm part of. I'm doing this because I've been part of that. And I've done that. And I'll do it more and more and more. That's what the path really is you come in more and more contact with certainty and become more and more incentivized and capable of incentivizing others. That's the whole path. So, I'll get better and better and better and better. I'll be more and more able to incentivize to certainty as I go along, for sure. And so will you. As soon as I throw something fun out there, the feminine energy immediately seizes upon it. Immediately. It says, oh, that looks like fun. They're just waiting for the fun. Oh, yeah, that's it. That's more like it. Yeah, that I feel comfortable. What they mean is I feel familiar. Oh, that's familiar territory to me. Of course. Because for eons and eons, we've been trying to incentivize doubt. So, of course, that's familiar territory. So just forgive yourself for that. Have compassion. Say, wow, I backslid there. Okay. It's not about fun. Okay, let me follow the incentive. Let me be incentivized towards certainty, not fun. But that's what happens. That's what happens. As soon as I put a little bit of fun in there, the feminine energy grabs upon it, and then the male energy says, hey, you know, my wife really likes that. That's great. We need more fun. She likes that. And when she likes it, that helps me like, because I get back into familiar territory following her lead, too. And the whole thing starts disintegrating right then and there. We're back to incentivizing doubt. So I have to be very careful about that, actually. Very, very careful. I immediately feel, uh-oh, I'm starting to go off track here. Yeah, that's not good for me. It's not good for anyone. Not in my mind, but just incentivized just by your presence. I mean, it's just people didn't need to say a word or do anything. At first, they wanted her to do some all the spiritual stuff, which was fun for them. And but later on, she said, no, you know, you got to go beyond that now. We have to get more towards, you know, more towards yoga and just presence. Silent presence is you know, like really high incentivization. Rama Maharshi, super high incentivization. He wasn't into fun at all, was he? And we think, oh my God, that's so powerful, right? We're not quite used to that. Well, we have to keep getting more and more used to it. They'd say, Ramana, sing us a song, come on. Ma, sing us a song. She'd, okay, but it's going to be your kirtan, you know, religious. Well, okay, but you know, can't we have a festival, Ma? Can't we dress up in beautiful saris? And she says, no, make it white. And, that's much fun. But can't we have some really good food? No, make it simple food. You know, can't we sing wonderful songs? No, make it simple religious songs. And then spend a lot of time in silence. Wow, that's difficult. We're not used to that. When we say it's difficult, we mean we're not used to it. Well, why are we not used to it? Because we've spent eons trying to fixate the mind. So, to try to get rid of insecurity of hallucination. So we can enjoy our disproportionate valuing realm, imaginary realm. Well, we'll never enjoy it. It's futile to try to enjoy a world is futile. Realm of doubt-based realm, it's futile. It's futile. To try and enjoy it is futile. That's why, there's a mosquito. I let it be. You know, maybe it may bite me, but hey, you know, what's it doing? It's incentivizing doubt, right? I'm a friend of mosquitoes too. Mosquito, I'm your friend, but I'm a yogin, so don't bite me. Maybe I'll be bitter to you, you know? Hopefully are too sweet. My blood is too sweet for the mosquitoes. They go, bah! I'm gonna go tell all their mosquitoes, don't bite this guy. I mean, it's, don't bite the yogin. It's too sweet. It's too much light there or something. I don't know, too much certainty there. It's no fun. Biting this yogin ain't no fun, you know? Come on, it says, yogin, we want to have fun sucking your blood. You got all these female vampires in the world now, right? They've got so much fun drinking blood, and the males fall right along like lemmings, right? Like lemmings. Yeah, let's drink each other's blood. That's fun. Yeah, you got so much depraved feminine activity in the world right now. It's just, I mean, it's time for this to all come out of the closet and tell it like it is, isn't it? Which is what we're doing here. They're so depraved. They're such whores. Femininity now is so whorish. Trying to incentivize fun in every possible way. Mutilation, you know. This is what's been going on the last 100 years. And it's taken, in the last 50, it's just taken off like crazy. And taken off more and more and more. You know, every kind of depravity. Now, females, matriarchy is trotting out every time. They want to have constant parades throughout every city and town in the world. Showcasing all the depravity of how many different ways we can try to, you know, incentivize doubt. Like, look, all this fun. You know, they'll have people, you'll be bleeding and mutilating, vampire parades, people sucking each other's blood. Of course they will. They're probably doing it already. They want to make sure the laws allow them. They're trying to change the laws. You know, we need, you know, those who agree with us to be the leader, so they get rid of all the laws that say, no, this is wrong. All the religious laws say it's horrible. These are laws against fun. That should be illegal to have laws against fun. They'll turn churches into brothels. They most certainly will. They're already pushing that to turn into, you know, festivals. Festival barrio, you know. Turn them into barrio fiestas. That's what they're after. That's what they're doing. And the priests are like, something. Guys, this isn't going the right direction. You might want to think about turning that around. Everybody's like, well, in one ear, out the other. But the priest said to me, like, this isn't going so well. Right? But, you know, they don't have any remedy. You know, because, well, Christians have a remedy. He said, we'll go somewhere else. Yeah. Christian, right? Hey, reptilians take over this planet. Guess what? Jesus already prepared a place for us. So, no biggie. Just shift there. So, we're not concerned. You know, as an apex yoga, I'm not concerned. If it gets bad enough here, we'll just shift to another realm. Easy. We'll Padmasambha it. You know, Padmasambhava it. Just, whew, we're there. We're already there. We're already there. I actually experienced going to another realm, how easy it was. It's like driving on a road. You just drive there and say, that was easy. Where am I now? Oh, gee, Toto, I don't think I'm in Kansas anymore. Wow, this is an amazing place. It's a different realm. Just is that easy. And of course, they're trying to make that illegal. Say, no, that's the no fun realm. You can't go there. That's a myth. You're make-believe. That's your imagination. I said, well, it's part of the path of divine imagination, bringing us back to certainty. So yeah, it's still imagination, but it's imagination incentivizing us returning to certainty. So that's a step, right step on the path. Well, but that's illegal. You can't go to another realm. They're trying to make it illegal to go to another realm. Good luck with that. You know, see ya. Wouldn't want to be ya. It's like, don't worry. We have drugs for that. We're working hard. We'll get an effective drug for that. We'll get an effective drug to fixate the mind. Don't worry. There's some drug out there that will fixate the mind. Don't worry. There's some drug that will fixate hallucination. We got our chemists really working on it, our scientists. We got computers working on it. And we got these promising compounds. And maybe we need to use you as a guinea pig because you look like a very promising subject for this because you're believing you can go to other realms. That's the very kind of mental problem we want to cure, you know. So here, let's give you some trial run. Let's use you as a guinea pig. We got some promising compounds here. That's what they're up to, isn't it? That's exactly what they're up to. So, yeah, we just found something in the Amazon. You know, it's like unbelievable. We just it looks like it's capable of fixating your mind. But we need to run trials on this first. Feel from the first, feel in from the last, feel all through and through. The dance of futility. Conditioned existence. The dance of futility. And they say, let's call it the majestic. You know, let's call it the boogie. Now we're doing the boogie. The dance of futility. But it's fun doing this dance of futility. We got these compounds. And we're doing the boogie and taking these compounds. And we're fixating our mind by doing that. Futile from the first, futile from the last, futile in between. We're doing the dance of futility. I'm the futility queen, you know, like that. And I do the rap thing. Yeah, I'm the futility queen, man. Yeah. And there's the futility queen, and she starts the futility dance. Yeah, futile from the first, futile from the last, futile in between. I'm the futility queen. Yeah. Boogie on down. Boogie on up, boogie on down. Boogie with me, boogie all around. Pop the compound. I am the boogie queen, the boogie compound queen. The disco queen, man. The disco queen's out on the floor. Don't you want a disco with me? Let's boogie on down into futility. Boogie, rap, pop drugs, yeah. Yeah, no. Futile. But futility's fun, they say. If you just can boogie to the beat of futility, yeah.
No mosquito.
Futility is fun if you can boogie to the beat of horrible, horrible, terrible defeat. Yeah, I'm the disco queen of futility. compounding my mind with Amazon novelty. Yeah. Come on, dance with me. Come on and dance with me. So, you know, you're either a male or a female listening to this, right? So to speak, your energy, you're identifying with that. But you're a pre-yogin, you're preparing to be a yogin, so you're saying, wow. Wow, this is better than fun. There's some kind of flow of certainty here. I it feels better than fun, actually. And it is. Because what we have in certainty cannot be defined as fun. It's beyond that. It's glory. It's glory. It's this glorious, indefinably glorious. Jesus said, it's so beyond your imagination, I'm not going to even try to define it or explain it to you. Just trust me. Okay, so. It's the flow of certainty. And it's, we can never represent that through fun. We can never represent that through bodies and fun. Not accurately, we can never accurately represent essence at all. We're trying to represent essence is impossible. So give it up. Prepare to give it up. That's all we're doing. We're preparing to give it up. I'm giving it up all for you. That means I'm giving up for fun. I'm giving up certainty for fun. That's what Disco Queen is grooving to. No. We're not giving up certainty for fun. We're giving up fun for certainty. We're giving up goriness for gloriness, you know? Right? Yeah. The horrible gore of doubt, you know, we're giving that up. It's all just gore, isn't it? It's the dance of gore. The algorithms of gore. That's what it is. And we're giving that up for the ceaseless glory of certainty. The ceaseless glory of certainty. The ceaseless glory of certainty as we flow through all value everywhere, equally everywhere. As we flow through all value equally everywhere. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. The Disco Queen is an unequal scene of depravity. It's a depravazine. Equal scene of depravazine. Whores and whoremongers on the scene, dancing along with the Disco Queen. Yeah, yeah, yeah. She loves you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. With a love like that. What is that? She loves you, yeah, yeah, with a love like that. You know you can't be, you shouldn't be seen, actually. With a love like that, you shouldn't be seen. She loves you, yeah, yeah, yeah. And love like that, you know you can't be wrong. Or what do they say? You can't be. You shouldn't be seen. You know, with a love like that, you shouldn't make that scene. You shouldn't make that scene of the yeah, yeah, yeah scene. The Beatles scene. The bizarre Beatles scene. The Beatles were incentivizing fun, and which is incentivizing doubt. Beatles were anti-dharmic, very anti-dharmic. Although George Harrison decided, this isn't it. The others were very anti-dharmic. Ringo, Paul, and John. John was extremely anti-dharmic. So was Paul. And so was Ringo. But George Harrison said, wait a minute. This is not exactly what I had in mind. I shouldn't have done this. You know, trying to incentivize fun. I think there's some higher purpose to life. Try chanting the names of the Lord and you'll be free. I mean, try having one musical phrase, just one, to flatten all music. You know, Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, like that. Just one song to flatten all other songs. He's saying, hey, I think that's better than this stuff. So George Harrison was trending towards being dharmic. So that's why the Beatles split up, because there was different divisions, and especially George Harrison. All things must pass. You know, he had some depth to him. He had some depth to him. And he tried to bring that in there, and so there was tensions, because the whole thing about the Beatles was an attempt to incentivize doubt through fun and to help the reptilians take over this planet. That was the Beatles' whole thing, Tavistock Institute creation, to help the reptilians out. Come on in. We're tired of this religious, non-fun culture, you know. We got to do better than that. Then we got into disco, you know, after the other ones. So we've gone spiraling down and down and down and down, down and down musically, down and down and down and down. Now, Dion's music was different. Earlier, before the Beatles, it was like more like, hey, this girl told me I'd have fun, but it turned into hell. It's like, wow, this ain't fun. Like, who is this Donna, the prima donna? She wants to incentivize me for fun, but she broke my heart. You know, now we're apart. You know, this ain't fun at all. Country music, so that music before the Beatles was still more dharmic. Okay, it was trending towards being dharmic, which is why I go back before the Beatles for my music, or to classic country, which was not contaminated by the British invasion so much. British invasion was a doubt contamination, catastrophic contamination of culture. The British invasion was a catastrophic contamination of culture. A lot of English people, British people, were addicted to speed from World War II. They used amphetamines for their soldiers. Cigarettes, coffee, and amphetamines was what won the war, basically, they think. And so that hops you up. And the Germans too. It was a chemical war. It was a war. They used chemistry. The German soldiers were strung out of methamphetamine. They used meth. Strong stuff. And so after the war, the surviving soldiers survived, and then their offspring had that energy too. They wanted the Beatles in Hamburg, like, play Mach Schnell, you know, Schnell, make more music, make music, make rock and roll, you know. And, you know, the Beatles, like, you know, all hopped up themselves on amphetamines. And that promotes the fun culture. So they did it in Hamburg, then they went to England, and then the English picked up on that because, and so then they looked at America and said, hey, you guys aren't having enough fun over there. You listen to Dion, you know, like, you know, winning, you know, where and when, and you're slow dancing over there. It seems like, you know, in the still of the night, wah, 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 wah. And you have all these morals and stuff. What the hell is that? The Beatles said, you guys need help. Here, we're here to help you. Yeah, 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 yeah. With a love like that, you know you can't be bad. It can't be bad. That's us. With a love like that, you know you can't be bad. You think you lost your love, but you saw her yesterday. You know she's thinking of, and you know there's what to say. Why she loves you, and you know that can't be bad. Yeah, the love like that, you know you can't be sad. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah. You know, and so they came in with that amphetamine, fun-inducing culture from drugs. They were all drugged up, the Beatles. Very, very wicked, decadent influence, the Beatles. And of course, the females just completely flipped over, completely flipped. Same over Elvis and Sinatra. They said, oh my God, you know. Here's how to have fun. We're remembering how to have fun. We're waking up. I think we're waking up. We're being empowered. Remember, oh, we're supposed to be having fun. We're feminine. Hear Miss Roar. We know the Beatles are teaching us how to have fun again. How to fast dance and jitterbug. I'll do all this fast dance. Oh, God. we've forgotten. We've been so repressed with dharmic culture about how to trend towards certainty. The beetles are really slime, but they're very catchy slime. Catchy slime. Very clever at it. Because they were so musical. You had Paul providing the musicality, Lennon providing the cynicality of it, George providing the soul, and Ringo providing the beat of it. But George at some point said, you know, hey, I'm, what am I using my soul for here, you know? This isn't right. I got carried away with my love of music, but I forgot the Dharma. You know, George realized, oh my, I woke up and said, hey, this isn't the right way. This isn't promoting the Dharma. This is promoting anti-Dharma. The Beatles were promoted anti-Dharma. They were anti-Dharmic, severely anti-Dharmic. But the females loved, flipped out, loved them. I was in fourth grade, I think it was fourth grade, British invasion, 64, I believe it was really 64, late 63, 64. So I would have been like third grade, maybe. I would be 8 years old. I don't know what's that, kindergarten, six, seven, first grade, maybe second grade. But I think it was third grade, more like second or third grade. And the girls, one day they were into, you know, Dion and slow dancing and doo-wop and, oh yeah, the slow, dharmic kind, more dharmic kind of slow-paced, more romantic kind of, let's take it easy here, strict morals, strict values, all that stuff. And the next day, the Beatles hit on Ed Sullivan, their wild televisions, and within weeks, they had totally changed. Like, they went into psychotic, they became psychotic. Almost all the girls, there were a few that weren't. They're saying, I don't know about this, you know. But by and large, almost all the girls, they went completely crazy for the Beatles and the British invasion. And they became, overnight, became decadent, became amoral, became wicked, became whorish. And I'm like, here am I trying to champion the Dharma, and I'm like, holy cow, this is horrible. You know, what has happened? Before, they were like, I was like the apple of their eye, you know, like this. They were listening to me. They said, this guy is telling us the truth. Let's pay attention to him. And then overnight, I didn't even exist anymore. And it was all about the Beatles. So we'll have the last laugh. Last laugh, Beatles. Okay. Your time has come and gone. Dion was better anyway. Okay, Dion was better than the Beatles. No doubt about it. This little girl made a fool out of me, you know. Dun, 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 dun. Yeah, that's a song. Honestly, the Beatles glamorized them and tried to say the girls are so special and so wonderful. They're goddesses. You know, they're just, that doesn't help anybody. That's whoremongering. The Beatles were whoremongers, plain and simple. They were whoremongers. Drug-addicted whoremongers. Who are very talented musically, but I said, I'm way more talented than they are musically, so let me try to use music to bring people back to the Dharma. But that didn't work. That didn't work once the horse is out of the barn, you know. Closing the doors doesn't help much. Because they're all on drugs, and they're all hopped up, and said, wow, I can see so many ways to have fun. You know, that's amazing. The women just went psychotic, severely psychotic. My whole generation went psychotic with the British invasion. And haven't got been able to get them back. You know, they're gone. They're goners in the short term. But Christians, of course, said the Beatles are evil, and they were right. They said all this fast dancing craze, it's evil. They were right. You know, they had Dharma. Christians have dharmic values, wise values that which trend towards certainty. So they were right. Boomers were wrong. And that's all there is to it. And so, you know, it's over with. I mean, it's out of the closet, cover's blown, and that was an episode. We had an episode of doubt. Okay, we lost our last call. The reptilians last called us. We got fooled. Okay, it's not, you have compassion on yourself. It was a cosmic conspiracy that took place. It was a reptilian thing with their Zeta Reticulan little allies and the mantoids and the various, there's a whole coalition of what we call ETs, doubt mongers. But not all ETs are doubt-mongers. Some are dharmic, actually. Okay, some ETs are dharmic. Just like some of us here are dharmic in this world. Some are anti-dharmic, doubt-based. There's some ETs that are trending more towards certainty. Some. Here and there. But the coalition that came to this world here were doubt-mongers. You know, they were incentivizing doubt. And so they pushed the right buttons, okay? They pushed the right buttons to incentivize doubt, and we fell for it because they cried out, hey, last call, everybody, last call. If you don't do it, remember, this is your last chance for doubt. I mean, last chance for fun, for doubt, your last chance for fun. If we're shutting down fun here in this world, you know. And they fell for the trick. We fell for the trick again. You know, Pete Townsend, we won't get fooled again. Well, Pete, you fooled us again. What do you mean we won't get fooled again? You did fool us again. You're the ones that fooled us again. So, forgive yourself, because it was a cosmic conspiracy. You weren't strong enough to handle it. Because you weren't a yogin yet. Yogins are strong enough to fight back against this and eventually overcome, you know, push it back. Forgive yourself. Go back into preparing to be a yogin. That's all. End of story. All the lies we've told ourselves. Ever since the British invasion, all we've been doing is telling ourselves lies. That's it. Trying to revise history. Say, oh, this stuff, all these people in the past. If they could, they would be doing what we're doing. But these evil laws and these evil people in the past, these conspiracies against fun, kept them enslaved. But if it weren't for that, they would have all been, you know, having fun like we're having fun now. No, Virginia, that's not true. That's a lie. They were having something way better than fun. They were trending towards certainty and freedom from this insane asylum of conditioned existence, this nightmare, hellish dream of doubt. Trying to fixate hallucination is hell. They were trending towards freedom. The freedom that is. So, we've been lied to. Since the British invasion, all we've heard is lies. That's all we've heard is lies. And the British invasion was a product of the reptilians pushing into this world. Through various think tanks, institutes, like the Tavistock Institute in London, or in England, and Europe, and all this various stuff. Those are the reptilians saying, no, let's incentivize doubt. So, cosmic conspiracy. It crushed us temporarily. But now we're coming back to life. We're being resurrected from the dead. And you have to keep being resurrected from the death of doubt. You know, the deadness that is doubt. You have to be resurrected from the deadness that is doubt. But we are inherently resurrectable. There's nothing that can be done about that. Because we're freedom of mind. So, no matter how many times they kill us, we always resurrect from the deadness of doubt. And so the sooner we just accept that fact, the less we'll fall for this. We say, oh, what's the use? Why should we go through it again? We'll just resurrect again. And just a waste, just an episode of delay, you know, is all it was. It's all it was. And so it doesn't matter how few people are listening to this video. This is going out into the mind, the one mind. So everybody is hearing this, actually. They're experiencing it in spirit, but those who are trying to separate from spirit, incentivize doubt, it's muffled. You know, they'd say, something there, but I'm not sure what it is. I doubt what that is. I have doubts about what that is. But it's there. Everyone's hearing this now. It's being broadcast throughout the world. Of course, those of you who watch these videos and hear, you help amplify it. So you're trending towards being a yogin. An apex yogin. The others, those who claim they're yogins are not apex yogins, they're actually pre-yogin. Because the apex yogin is actually practicing what truly works, which is flattening conditioned existence, flattening the belief in disproportionate value, flattening it by the use of just one term, one action, one fun, one definition, just that. That's apex yoga. And that's what actually works. The other stuff is just still, you're just still dancing around. It doesn't really work. you're kind of saying, let me dance around for a while, play the game of spirituality, while I still got my eye on the fun. So that's not a genuine yogin. All genuine yogins are apex yogins, actually. And they all are practicing in this way, whatever labels. Nisargadatta was an apex yogin before he was, liberated in abundance. He was an apex yogin, and he went to his guru, who was in abundance. And his guru, when he saw him one time, and his guru said, "Just practice this way. You're ready for it. Just flatten all concepts totally. Just all feeling. Just I am, or just amness. Just beingness. Just that. I am that. Just that." And he just said, "Okay." And immediately said, "That's what I need to do." And he started doing it. And he did it night and day for like 4 or 5 years. And that was the end of it. Then this beautiful tranquility, the peace of God dawned upon him. And he got more and more in abidance in this. And he was done. Sargadatta Maharaj, he was done. He was liberated. Just that simple. But when he was practicing, he was an apex yogin. Absolutely he was. And we can do exactly the same thing as he did. But we will be the guru of our own path, so it will be unique, our own path, to us. So, heavy video, right? A lot of weight in this video, weighty video, in other words, it weighs us towards certainty. This video has a very heavy weight towards certainty. Gurus are heavyweights, meaning they put heavy weight on the scale of our evaluation. It heavily incentivizes us towards certainty. That's a guru. Sri Srinand Maimai is the guru of gurus, because there's never been anyone heavier than her to incentivize us towards certainty. Ramana is also, Dharma kings are in that same echelon. But she did it in all ways. She permeated the entire dream with her certainty. Through all socialization, all activity, all fun, everything, she permeated it all with her certainty, with her heavyweightness. So she really is the guru of gurus. What she did was so effective that it would go on to the end of time. It was that effective. She completely permeated the entire dream of doubt with certainty. Which has been super helpful for me. Without her, I couldn't have made it. I could not have made it to where I am now. No way. Even with A Course in Miracles, I couldn't have made it. Because the culture is so collapsing. And so she permeated all of it. All of it. They dress her up in all sorts of goddess costumes and everything. And yet, she was there in perfect certainty. No matter what they did to her, how they told her to dance, she'd say, "Okay, doesn't matter. Doesn't affect me in any way." You see, she permeated it all. Didn't touch her. So every aspect of the dream, they tried out, and it didn't touch her at all. They tried it out, just about in every which way, and she just permeated it so much that it's all there, everywhere. And it's so. Guru of gurus, no doubt about it. And those who met her, they all said that. All these gurus said, "Oh my gosh, this is the guru of gurus. This is God himself in the world. This is the guru of gurus here." Well, this is divinity, you might say. This is appearing here in the world, and this is above us. She met all the top gurus. They just say, "Hey, homage. You are the guru of gurus. Wow." It's true. So, we're very fortunate in that regard. And I've benefited immeasurably from that. The only reason I'm able to speak this way is because of Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma. Specifically, to give the context to it. Now, all the Dharma kings, Jesus has been super, super, super helpful. I couldn't have made it without him either. You can say this about all the Dharma kings. But to be able to speak this way, Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma is the one that put me over the top, be able to speak in a kind, gentle, dharmic way of, and say what's being said here in the way that I'm saying it, I wouldn't be able to do it if she hadn't come into this world. That is for sure. We would be way worse off if she hadn't come into this world. Or she knew what was coming here, the reptilian invasion. And so that's why she came into the world, to permeate the whole world with her grace before the reptilian invasion happened. And she did. So the reptiles are saying, "The son, Doc, got it. We don't quite, you know. Okay, too late. Too late. Too late for the lizards. They came too late. Blame it on her, lizards. You know, you failed, ultimately. Dude, doggone it, it seems like someone came here before we did and messed everything up for us. Yeah. But they still may get their scales on this for a while. So they can have their mass extinction right here. That's what they came here for. Everybody, let's have a mass extinction event party. When the asteroid hits, let's all be engaged in an orgy with completely whacked out on every kind of drug and every kind of food, and be drinking each other's blood, and you know, and then we can all die together. And hey, that might fixate the mind, you know, might fixate the mind. They're gonna have an end of the world party. I'm gonna miss that party. That's one party I want to miss. Not into parties anyway. Never have been. I never attended parties. That's one. You know, it's amazing. I may have went to maybe a couple. I hated them so much I left right away. I just hated parties. I'm super non-party person, because the party is in my mind all the time. Why do I need to try and attend a party? What do you mean attend a party? I am the party. You know, that's how I think. I am the party. Why should I leave? I am. I am is always the party. There's nothing but this glorious party going on. It's everywhere. All value, always everywhere. Yeah. You know, I just pray that there are those watching these videos. If you watch these videos, tell others, like, hey, you don't want to miss this. I mean, but what can I do? I can't force anyone. Because these are more than fun. I mean, this is just flattening fun. They say, wow, this is superior to fun. This is something else. They're all together. This is like, it feels like freedom, actually, is what it feels like, doesn't it? And we say, I didn't realize I could be this free in the world. My God, this is way better than sex, drugs, and rock and roll, that, you know, kind of thing. That wasn't freedom. What was I doing? This feels like freedom. This feels light and freedom and clarity. Oh, the clarification. The clarity. I love clarity. I love this clarification. Oh, okay, I did fall. I can have compassion on myself. How wonderful. I can just put, this was a last call doubt episode, cosmic conspiracy, last call trick. And we got tricked again, but now we're seeing it. And you know what? I got the feeling I'm not going to be tricked. That was the last time I'm ever going to be tricked. For me, it is the last time I'm ever going to be tricked. I know that. I've been told, the Dharma King's told us, you will not be fooled again. Because you caught it this time. You caught it, and you worked on it, and you've done a great job, and you won't be fooled again. You will not be fooled again. So you will remain dharmic forever. You will remain dharmic forever. So that's a fact. So that feeling that I'm going to remain dharmic forever is being conveyed, and you say, I like that feeling. I'd like to remain dharmic forever too. Right? So that's this aha, like, wow, freedom forever. Perfect freedom forever. I want that. I like that. I'm trending in that direction. So you're getting the vibe from the video here. You're getting that vibe here. Yeah. It's a cool vibe, and I don't have to dance to it. I'm my own dance. I'm my own guru. Wow. I'm an apex wow yogin. Wow. I'm an apex wow yogin. Wow. I'm an apex wow yogin, wow. Now, I'm not getting any traction on Facebook at all. Zero. Well, now, minuscule. There's a few, but they're just trending.
Right.
It's like, yeah, thanks, but I'm not practicing it. It's too much fun. I see too much the world. It still seems to be a lot of fun. But once you're an apex yogin, it's not like you can't play golf again. I haven't played golf since I'm an apex yogin. I haven't played golf, though. I haven't done much of it. I went, the beach thing was a fun thing, but that was a last call thing, too, kind of.
Right, yeah.
It started out fun, but then when the storms came, it got crazy. It got scary. And when these huge telephone poles surged past my legs, I didn't see them because they were so foamy, and they're going like about 10 miles an hour. You get hit by a telephone pole at 10 miles an hour, that's not good for your legs. And I'm out in the water, and again, both my legs were crushed and broken. Guess what? I fall on my face in the water, and I drown. And there's nobody there. I said, wow, this is like a death sentence. So fun leads you into death. It's how death disguises itself, actually, fun. Because what happens, all these people are running around having fun, they end up in these gruesome, terrible deaths. And, because fun disguised it. So that's what happened at the whole beach thing. But this recognition was necessary. The whole thing is necessary to lead us away from that, to go through this whole thing, and to be able to be friends, remain friends. You have to remain friends with everyone. So, I have to have an overall, Dharma Prince has to be able to feel equal value always everywhere-ness, and apply that to everyone, you see. Has to be a wide perspective. So I was aware that what's going to happen in the world, it showed me what's going to happen in the world, is all this foaminess is going to arise. Of course, out of San Francisco is the home of foam. Home of foam. And I'm not homophobic, I'm homophobic. I'm homophobic. Because the foam hides what's under the surface. You can't see. See, I was out in this storm, this like unbelievable storm, where there's so much foam, everything was covered, the whole ocean was covered with foam, you couldn't see under the surface. And the storm was so powerful, it had swept all this heavy debris into the ocean. So there's all this wood, which floats, heavy timber, and telephone poles, and beams and stuff. Wood, and the tide was surging, as it was surging in the water, and you couldn't see it. I couldn't see it. So I was out there taping the foam in the water, and it was up to my waist. And suddenly, something bumped my leg. I said, what the heck is that? Oh, it was a board. And then I saw something else surge past me as it went in. It was covered with foam. I couldn't see it, but got uncovered by foam as it went up towards the beach, came to the beach. And I said, holy cow, that just surged past me. It just missed me. And that's a telephone pole. And I kind of said, oh, I'm glad it missed me. And so this kept happening. And then I thought, wait a minute. What if it hit me? I realized it missed me by like 5 feet or maybe 10 feet. It was very close. Because I finally saw it, you know, as it surged up the beach. I said, wait a minute. I saw the trajectory. I said, wait a minute. That just went right past me. I said, if that was 10 feet over, it would have hit my legs, and I would have drowned. I said, this isn't so fun anymore. I said, wait a minute, this is a death setup, isn't it? And then I suddenly realized, yeah, I got to get out of here. This is a setup for death. So the foam represents fun. Okay, and the whole fun culture came out of San Francisco. I mean, the British invasion came out of British invasion, and then San Francisco, the psychedelic 60s, it also came out of L.A. and San Francisco, the fun culture, California fun culture. and has been exported throughout the world. And this, so this fun culture, I was up in San Francisco, this ocean there, and this fun culture is disguising what? Something incoming. Something in the ocean of space coming in towards us and hitting us. A telephone pole going into the beach real fast. What's that? It's an asteroid. The ocean represents space. You can't, and the foam represents fun. We're so distracted, we don't realize what's coming towards us from space. Now, the Holy Spirit keeps telling me, hey, asteroids are coming, space rocks are coming, they're going to hit the Earth. Collective suicide here, extinction level event. It's all the mind, that's how doubt is dancing. That's how doubt wants to try and fixate. And death is an attempt to provide evidence of fixation of mind. Collective death, we feel, is more powerful than individual death. So we're arranged a vast collective death here. But we're distracting ourselves from that with all this foam of fun, so we don't decide, wait a minute, maybe that's, you know what, that's kind of insane. So let me shift my dwelling place so I don't experience collective death. Or let me be protected. Let me call upon the protection of God so I don't experience collective death. I'm not into that. There's something wrong about that. I gotta reevaluate that. No, we're so distracted by fun that we don't pay any attention to it. So that's what I was shown. That's what I was shown. So it was all great. It was all good. I was protected, of course, but I was being shown that what's happening. I said, wow, I'm going to get out of this ocean. That's enough. That's enough. It was amazing. I mean, we can make fun very foamy and amazing and very creative. And I was videotaping it, and it was like, God, it was unbelievable. It was so creative. It was mind-blowing. But I said, at some point, I said, okay, you know what? This is stupid also, and that's enough of that. Thanks, but that's enough. So thank you, world, for all this fun you're offering me, but I'm going to step back from it for a while now. So I stepped back from it. It was the most intense experience of my life. There's no question about it. And I was the intrepid one out there filming it all, taping it all. Nobody else was daring that, you know. It was the most intense experience of my life. I cannot even explain it. And I have videos of it, of course, and I've put up some pictures and videos of it, and not out to the public so much because it's too intense. It might incentivize them towards doubt. You know, the key thing is the message that this, you know, is hiding catastrophe that's coming upon this world. We're distracting ourselves from it. And the sign that we were told to look for is certainly September 23rd-ish, that week, is the sign that we were told to look for of 217. The Virgin crowned with the stars and cloaked in the sun, cloaked and the moon at her feet, and about ready to give birth was Jupiter being expelled from her womb. At that time, that astrological complex is only present September 23rd, 217, for the last 7,000 years. So for sure, that's the sign. And then after that, the terrible dragon comes and casts down a third of the stars in the sky. It means incoming space rocks and meteorites, showers, make it look like the stars are coming down to the Earth. It's an extinction level event for collective suicide to try and fixate the mind. Now, it's possible that the Holocaust, the Jews tried to prevent this. It's possible they tried to prevent this from happening by saying, no, let us make a sacrifice. We'll sacrifice, collective sacrifice, and so you don't need to do that one. But that's an Old Testament thing. It's an Old Testament thing. They may have had an altruistic motive behind it. And say, look, let us fixate the mind. We think we know how to do it, and you won't have to have this extinction level of it. But you can't fixate the mind, so it didn't work. It didn't work. That's Old Testament stuff. The Christians are praying like, no, we got Jesus' sacrifice. We don't need this. Well, that doesn't work either, because it's still believing that sacrifice works to fix it. The mind can be fixated. So Jesus came with A Course in Miracles. There's this beautiful pigeon, right? A mourning dove or something. There's a mourning dove right here. Coo, 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 coo. Jesus, so the Jesus way, trying to say, no, we can stop it through prayer, doesn't work, because they still believe in fixating the mind. But Jesus brought A Course in Miracles way, which tells us you can't fixate the mind. So that then opens the door to stepping back from it, shifting locales, you know, because the ones that want to try and fixate the mind, they're going to try and do something collectively. It's obviously a collective energy here, collective endeavor, a group endeavor, collective endeavor to die collectively. And the Jews are saying, wait a minute, we already did the big sacrifice. You don't need to do that. And they're not listening to that, you know. And Jesus says, wait, and the Christians say, wait, we already had Jesus died for one sacrifice for all sacrifices, the most powerful sacrifice of all, so you don't need to do this. And they're not listening to that. And so we're saying, hey, look, folks, they're not listening, okay, and they're not going to listen, so we better exercise the final option, is let's shift to some other locale. Because that's what Jesus said he's going to have to do, because they won't listen. He's prophesied they will not listen to you. They will not. And then the end times, the evil and adulterous generations, they will not listen to you at all. Reptilian-based, last call lie. They're under the influence of this last call lie. And so he said, I'll come back, and I've gone to prepare a place for you, and I'll come back to take you there. Plain and simple. Very simple and unambiguous, actually. So we must not be distracted by fun at this point. We must not be distracted by fun. And the one way to do that is to just have one small fun. Okay, like for me, singing. So the rest of the fun, I'm not even interested in. I've got my fun. I don't need any of the other stuff. I'm not interested in at all the rest of the way the world's having fun right now, which is billions of different ways, actually, right? My wife told me about these women now that are into these babies, wax babies or something. Like, she said, they're completely insane. They're insane. Crazy. And they're collecting hundreds of these lifelike wax babies, and they're thinking they'd be real and stuff. That's their way of having it. You know, they're obsessed with that. And then the Barbies, you know, the Barbie movement, right? I get a lot of Barbies on Facebook trying to friend me. It's like, and I look, I said, what, are you real? Or is this a wax dummy or what? And you look mantoid, actually. You look mantoid. It comes from mantoid ETs. This insect look. They have this insect look. They're trying to look like insects, actually. So that's their, you know, obsession. Trying to have fun like that. Yeah, and okay, that's all fine. I mean, I don't hate on anyone. It's just like, wow. I wow it. It's like, wow. But I cut out the whores, you know. I mean, if they're, you know, trying to, hey, let me send you some pictures. No. You know. But for me, it's just singing, like with Dion. Sing with Dion. Or the Beach Boys, you know, pre-British Invasion stuff. Beach Boys and Dion were pre-British Invasion. Whole different vibe to it. Whole different vibe. Non-reptilian vibe, really. So it is. It's not dharmic, but it's trend. It can trend towards being dharmic. You can easily trend it in that way. And she'll have fun till her daddy takes the T-bird away, you know. But you knew all along your dad was getting wise to you now. And since he took your set of keys, you've been thinking that your fun is all through now. But you can come along with me, and because we got a lot of things to do now, and we'll have fun until her daddy. Now that daddy, we'll have fun now that daddy took the T-bird away. We'll have fun until now that daddy took your T-bird away. What they're getting at is the fun of the world, you know, which is based on lies. Why'd you have to lie to God? Your daddy stands for God. But if you come along with me, I mean, to certainty, trend towards certainty, we'll have never-ending glory. That's way beyond the fun of the flesh. Okay, that song can easily trend in that direction, you see. You find that the songs are, you can easily trend towards dharmic. You can interpret the lyrics that way. And I suddenly interpreted Dion's lyrics that way. I said, oh my God, this is super dharmic. The Wanderers is super dharmic, actually. I don't fixate, no. Yeah, I'm just, I flow. I completely flow, and I don't get caught up in this incent game, female incentive game of incentivizing doubt, and I don't follow along. I'm not into that. And it goes like that. So it's awareness of the dangers of female incentivizing doubt, and how culture needs to hummingbird right here. Hovering right here. Right beside me to the right here. The hummingbird was just hovering right there. Like 2 feet, maybe, no, 3 feet away. Almost could touch it. It was just, I don't know how I was hovering there. Wow. So the dangers to men of unleashing the beast of female incentivization, that female energy, which is incentivizing fun, and men have, you know, follow along like lemmings. So of course men are scared of that. Says, holy cow, we can't have that. And females are scared of it too. Scared of men being lemmings. Lemmings say, hey, don't be lemmings. You know, be dharmic, please. Because we start incentivizing fun, you just follow along like lemmings. That's horrible. We don't. So both have to tell each other, don't do that. You know, don't do that. Don't be a lemming. And we say, don't be a whore. You know, don't be a whoremonger and don't be a whore. Neither one. Neither one. So, we're scared for those safeguards, to drop all those safeguards. And we've dropped, in our culture, in American culture, we've dropped all those safeguards. All the safeguards, dharmic safeguards that we had set up to help us. Collapsed them. And now everybody's just gone crazy. Foamy. They've gotten all foamy. They've gone all foamy. I brave the foam out there in the ocean to deliver the dharmic message here. I'm braving the foam. But at some point, it's time to get out of the foam. So that's what it was. I mean, I went out in the ocean. I videotaped all this foam and the play of the foam, and it was surging past me. Huge banks of foam. It was up to my waist, you know. It was boom! I was hit by the foam. But it was soft. The foam was soft. But the hidden logs beneath the foam aren't soft. So we think, oh no, we have this soft culture, it's all soft, it's all feminine, it's nice. It's a disguise for collective suicide. So when the space rocks come in, they aren't so soft, okay? They aren't so soft. They aren't so softly feminine, are they, the space rocks hitting the planet? They're kind of hard when they hit. It's like those telephone poles in the water. Get hit by those, that's not foam. Whoops, that wasn't foam that just hit me. And I got bumped a bunch of times by boards, and that tipped me off. Said, uh-oh, this is, and gradually my awareness gone. This ain't safe at all. This is super dangerous. So playing around the foam right now is super dangerous. I don't advise it. But I don't advise trying to crush all fun, because you'll have a rebound effect, and you'll become then either a whore or a whoremonger again. So don't crush all fun. Give yourself just one little bit of fun, whatever it may be, okay? That's your personal decision. For me, it's singing. And maybe you play a little golf. Maybe I'll sing while I play golf. The singing golfer. Yeah. But I haven't played golf yet, so I don't know if I'm going to or not. I don't know how I'm going to be incentivized, how the Dharma Kings will incentivize, you know, certainty. I don't know. But they, at least I believe they have told me I'll be playing golf. But, you know, that could be the ego that's been saying that. I don't know for sure. Not for sure. Not 100% for sure. Certainly, it seems I'm being incentivized to just retreat from the world and play some golf and get ready for Jesus, you know, a better place, a better realm. Better realm. Better realm is coming for the yogins for sure. To get ready for that. And I don't know how many will be able to go, but maybe pre-yogins, those who are really very strongly pre-yogin, may also go, be able to go, possible, because there'll be great teaching there. So if you're used to being incentivized by Dharma princes, then you may be able to go there too. That is very possible. I don't know. I don't have those details at all. I will very likely go there, very likely, you know. I'm not going to set in stone, because I have to stay humble. I have to stay humble. I'm not going to count my chickens for their hatch, so I'll keep working at it. I mean, staying humble means you keep working full blast towards it. You know, you don't say, I've got it, because then you get lazy. So I keep working at it. Yeah, it's heavy stuff, huh? But we're making it lighter. I'm trying to bring light into it. Bring light. But there are not many people. They're too obsessed with having fun. They say, you know, like, I know something really important to happen. I gotta have fun. But they think of the collective extinction will give them fun in the future, because the mind will then be fixated and they won't feel insecure with hallucinating the absence of God. That doesn't work. It won't work at all. It'll have zero effectiveness really down the road. You can imagine it will have effectiveness for a while, but always the fear reemerges, you know, the insecurity of hallucination reemerges and bam, hits you and you say, oh my God, I'm here it comes again, you know. It seems like we stood this way, the same way. We dressed in the same way, we spoke in the same way, but I don't know where or when, you know. It feel this, here comes that feeling again, but I don't know where and when. It seems like here comes that fear again. I didn't know where or when, but here it comes again. You know, maybe you'll be in a different world, different incarnation, and here it comes again. Insecurity, I thought. So that's what happens. So we have the big picture of it, and we'll keep working on what a beautiful day it is here. It's kind of, we got a cool breeze. It was kind of warm in the sun, but with a nice, soft, cool breeze. California dreaming. But, you know, everyone's out having fun, where I'm having more than fun by taping this. This is way more fun than anybody else is having in California. I'm having the most fun in California. Winner! You know. But it's actually not fun. It's pre-glory. I'm being incentivized. That's even better than fun. I'm being incentivized by certainty. I'm being incentivized by certainty. That's better than fun. Whereas everybody else in California today, they're out trying to find fun. They're in search of fun. In search of fun flowers. Not sunflowers, fun flowers. They say, well, this is fun. We're having fun. Oh, let's stop here. Let's pig out on some food and have some fun and put some rock on, you know, put some rap on the radio and drive around fast and look at some flowers and come home and stuff our faces with more food. We're having fun. It's a fun day we had. Because in California, you're supposed to have fun. That's the religion of California, is fun. California dreaming on such a winter's day. So we could be having fun in California. Yep, that's anti-dharmic, you would say. So I haven't had much fun in California. I've sampled the fun, yeah, but I said, that's not that fun. So I've had fun being incentivized by the Dharma Kings and the grace of God. But that's not fun. It's more than fun. I've been inspired. And I say, well, I'm not really missing. I don't miss the fun. The inspiration is better than fun. Inspiration towards trending towards freedom is better than fun. But people say, you're leading such a boring life, or so pity you. What a boring life you're leading. I say, no, I pity you. You're leading such a nightmarish life, such a hellish life, because you don't understand that no matter how you try to fixate the mind, it doesn't work, and then you try to experience the fruits of your labor, so this extinction level event coming is collective suicide, and then you're doing that to think because that'll be fruitful. So you have this huge belief this will work. What does that mean? That means you're hell-bent to have another life in this hallucination of disproportionate value as a body to experience the fruits of your success. So you will be reborn to experience the fruits of your success, and you will find out it wasn't successful. And at that point, you'll just say, oh, ay caramba. You know, it's like, oh my God, it didn't work. And then you'll go into denial about that, and you go into psychosis, you know, severe acute psychosis over that. And then, you know, you'll turn to the grace of God ultimately. But you will return to experience the results of your experiment, you know, your attempt. Of course. Collective suicide is an attempt to produce fruits down the road. It's fertilizing the fruits of doubt. The tree of doubt. It's an attempt to pile massive amounts of fertilizer on the tree of doubt. And then you are born again into the garden of doubt, so you can eat the fruits of this tree of doubt. And what are those fruits? Well, they're still bitter fruits. See, we're trying to sweeten the fruit of the tree of doubt, and those fruits are still, no matter what we do, they're horribly bitter. And they cause you cancer, you know. They're cancerous. And you say, my God, it didn't work. We got to pour more fertilizer, but I'm tired of that, right? I just don't have the will to do that anymore. And then you say, well, then you start trending towards being a yogin. Trend towards being a yogin. Be incentivized. Let the Dharma Kings incentivize you. That's what works. I feel great today. I don't know why. I mean, it's a beautiful California day. That helps. You know, it's a spectacular day. I enjoy the warmth that makes me feel better, but I just feel light. I feel confident. Of course, it's springtime, which is nice too. Going towards summer, which I love summer. So summer's going great, 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 great. The stillness of summer. Nothing moving, everything just quiet. Lazy and quiet, still. Just I don't want to take any action. I don't want to. It's too hot to have fun. I just want to sit here. I don't want to even eat. It's very dharmic. Summertime can be very dharmic. The heat can be very dharmic. Sometimes the cultures that have really hot desert climates, a lot of saints come from there. Southern India, Ramaharshi, you know, very hot in the summer. You just can't move. Can't move. So humid and hot, you don't want to move. It's very helpful. Dharmic, very dharmic. And cold climates tend to be very anti-dharmic. Everyone's super industrious. Got to be busy all the time. Got to accumulate extra, extra, extra for the wintertime. But in the hot desert climates, you just eat some dates, you know, eat a few dates, drink a little water, and just sit there. And what do? You sit there, you meditate. Hey, let me look at my mind. It's too hot to do anything else, so let me turn within and become introspective. So hot desert climates are very conducive to introspection. And the glorious palm tree just gives you the dates. So your food is dates and water, kind of. Maybe you might have a few roots. You know, it's a very simple diet in the hot desert. Simple diet and some water. Very simple life. Just because you can't be too active, it's too hot. And you're just kind of in the shade, sitting there in the shade. Very dharmic. I love it. I love it. I don't like the cold weather. You have to be really busy, hustling and bustling all the time. I got to get fuel for the fire, you know. In the hot climate, you just sit in the shade with linen clothes, you know, white linen clothes covering you, and you just sit, don't move, and sit quiet, and you're okay. As soon as you try to move around, it's too hot. So you just sit very quietly. So it helps you develop this quiet sitting. I mean, southern India, I mean, could just be a blast furnace. It was last year. I mean, they had this heat wave, right? It's like 115, or I mean, it was super, super inhumid. I mean, oh my God! It could stay that way till the monsoon season arrives. So it could be months and months in the southern India. It's just blistering, and in India in general is blistering. That helps them. That helps them be dharmic. Now the Tibetans, on the other hand, was so formidably cold. Ferocious high Himalayas, that too, sit in a cave, you look for a cave, let's just sit in the cave and have the little fire and, you know, not do much because it's so inimical. That's helpful for them. That was helpful. But a temperate climate, in a just sort of a seasonal climate, is very non-dharmic, actually, very non-dharmic. You're constantly busy, you have the American culture so busy because it's temperate climate here. For the most part, so busy. Everybody is always frantically pursuing fun here in this culture. But the lovely desert, 115 degrees, oh God, that's wonderful. Blast furnace, you just, holy cow, I think I just better sit here. And it's too hot to think, right? So you're thinking, let me just minimize my thinking. Because thinking leads to action. Seeking fun, doesn't it? And you say, no, I don't want to seek fun right now. No, let me just sit here. So thoughts become your enemy at that point, and you realize they're the enemy. So naturally you tend to trend towards minimizing action, which means minimizing thoughts, which means minimizing evaluation. And you say, how can I stop, you know, how can I, if I just wow every thought that arrives, I don't not induced to do anything. I said, wow, I should do this. Wow, I should do this. Wow, I should do this. Wow. I have an idea. Wow. I have an idea for fun. Wow. I have an idea. Wow, wow, wow. And you just keep dissolving all these ideas for fun when it's that hot. And you can even play golf in the heat, but take it easy. And you practice, you know, I have to be very still in my mind and actions and stuff, even to have any fun at all in this heat. So it's a very, very dharmic place and practice. But a lot of people who are non-dharmic, they don't like it. No, I can't pursue my fun like I want to. How can I incentivize doubt in such an atmosphere? Terrible. That's like that. So hopefully the Dharma Kings can incentivize certainty through some desert heat. I would love that. I pray for that every day. My prayers are all desert heat, please. I need the desert heat. I need 4 months. I need May, June, July, August, or June, July, August, September, let's say, the hottest months. I'll take June, July, August, September in the desert any day. Let it be 110 every day. I pray for that. I pray for that. Let me just sit under a palm tree. Let me just sit under a palm tree all day and drink some water. Drink some vitamin water. Eat some dates. Have a date milkshake. I mean, hey, live it up. I love date milkshakes. They're awesome. Wow. They're so good. Date smoothie. I should make a date smoothie, actually. I have the dates. Maybe I will do that for breakfast right now with chocolate protein powder. I think I'll go do that. Chocolate protein powder, put in dates, medjool dates, pitted medjool dates, some orange juice, maybe as a base, and then chocolate protein powder, and maybe some vitamin water, and that's my smoothie. Make a shake, though. You put in almond milk. Put in almond milk. I don't have any almond milk. I'll put in chocolate protein powder. Drink. Chocolate protein drink. Dates. Chocolate protein powder. Some OJ. That's my breakfast. What time is it? It's 11. 1111. I always look at that. 1144. Perfect. Look at my watch. It's 111. 1111 and 44 seconds. Numerology. I get 111 all the time. All the time, 1111 lines up, and 444, 1444, 1444, 1444. I don't know if 44 is an extinction level event. It might signify extinction level event. Actually, really, seriously, it's a warning. I believe 44 is a warning. It could very well be that. Because every time I turn to the Holy Spirit, it always says extinction level event is coming. Always. And I just, oh, God, again, yeah, come on. I want to have some fun. No, that's not it. Come on. maybe it's... Anyway, that date shake is calling. I have never thought, I said, well, I could do that. I have the Nutribullet. I can puree dates. Wow. My weight was pretty good this morning. That burrito is exiting me. thank God, no more burritos. But a date shake? Come on. Throw a little cinnamon in there. I could use vanilla. Actually, I have vanilla. Or maybe I'm out of that. But I had a vanilla protein drink. Maybe I'd be out of it now. But I could use that too. That would be a heck of a shake. Wow, chocolate and or vanilla date shake smoothie. And that's all you need for the day. That's your food for the day. It's pretty thick. It'll be really thick. Drink some of it. Sip, drink. And you'll find after you drink about a glass full, you're full. And then pour water or some kind of very thin drink in it. It could be cherry juice or something. And then blend it again, and then it's thinner. And then drink a couple more of that, and then do the same and blend it again. That's even thinner. And by the end of the day, it's almost like water. And then you finish it and have some toast maybe. That's my food for the day. I could even throw some cashew butter in the smoothie. Yeah. Dates, cashew butter, chocolate protein drink and chocolate protein powder, and some OJ or whatever. Hey, now we're talking. Now we're talking. Or sesame seed, tahini, sesame seed butter. That would also be awesome. Man, I'm getting hungry right now. So, all right, great way to end it. I'm going to have some fun with food right now. I allow myself a smoothie fun. I've collapsed all fun with food into just these smoothies. That's it. You know, collapsed all entertainment into just me singing. You know, collapse all recreation into just fun with golf. You know, so collapse everything into just one fun type of thing. But avoid the whorishness and the whoremongering. And avoid the gambling. Okay, you don't want to do that. That would be anomalies. I mean, if you're an anomaly, okay. Okay, I'm friends with everybody. If you're a rare anomaly, okay, but we're not going to promote that here, okay? We're not going to promote rare anomalies, because if you promote rare anomalies for everyone else, that just leads them into disaster. Leads them into disaster. So, okay, I'm going to have some food fun with date smoothie. I got to find the dates, but I will find them. I know we have a bunch of them. I got this real good bargain on dates. Down the desert, dates are cheap. You can get all the dates you want. So date smoothies galore. Here we go. I get lip balm too for my lips to keep them from getting drying out too much. Wow. I'm an apex wow yogin. Wow.